Hi, Robert Rotenberg here. I'm happy to introduce my fifth and final session of my Chapter One sessions that I've done on Monday nights in May and June of 2020. At the last session, this one, we talked about my fifth novel, Heart of the City, and I gave a preview of my new novel, which is called Downfall. It's going to be out in February 2021. If you want to check out the previous four sessions, simply go to my website, robertrotenberg.com, or you can catch them on YouTube. Thanks for everyone who's helped me out with this, especially my daughter Helen Rotenberg and everyone who participated. It's been a lot of fun. Thanks. Okay, here we go. Session five of my Chapter One series. It's June 15th, my brother's birthday, 2020. I'm going to start this one off in a bit of an unusual way. I'm not sure how many of you recognize that song. It was written by a musician who's been performing for 60 years and just a few weeks ago got his first ever number one hit on Billboard. His name is Robert Zimmerman, otherwise known as Bob Dylan, Nobel Prize winner from Hibbling, I think it's Hibbling, Minnesota, northern Minnesota. And I'll tell you why I played that to begin this. As we go through, this being the last session, I want to take a few minutes. I said I'm not doing this to promote myself, and I'm really not, but I'll take 10 seconds to do a little promo. All five of my books are still available, although some people lately had a bit of trouble getting them from Indigo, so we're going to take care of that. You can find them all on my website. They're all available and on audio and on downloads. And I want to let you know that next February, probably February 2nd, my sixth book, which is called Downfall, is going to be coming out. And as a little favor, the way publishing works, the first week of publishing is crucial. So any of you who can pre-order or buy it or get all your friends to buy it, I'd really appreciate it. A lot of you have asked about teaching, and actually, I've already got a new student, one here. I'll get back to all of you. I think I want to do that on an individual basis because you can see I'm very, very detailed oriented. And tonight's going to be a little bit longer. You don't have to stay for the whole thing, but we've got a few little surprises tonight. So to start, I want to go back to book one. You'll remember I started with chapter one of book one, and I read you the opening page, and I asked you what Mr. Singh looked like. I'm not going to read the whole thing again. I'm just going to give you a little reminder, and then we're going to find out what Mr. Singh looks like. The mystery will be solved. Chapter one. Much to the shock of his family, Mr. Singh rather enjoyed delivering newspapers. Who would have thought Gurdial Singh, former chief engineer for Indian Railways, the largest transportation company in the world, would be dropping newspapers at people's doors, commencing at 5:05 each morning? He entered the marble-appointed lobby of the Marketplace Tower, a luxury condominium on Front Street, and gave a friendly wave to Mr. Rashid, the night concierge. The Globe and Mail newspapers were neatly stacked just inside beside a diminutive plastic Christmas tree. How strange, in a country covered in forests, that they would use plastic trees, Mr. Singh thought, as he hitched up his gray flannel pants and bent down to cut the binding cord with his pocket knife. Well, I asked you folks if you'd like to tell me what Mr. Singh looked like, and so the mystery is solved, because Terry wrote in that he's wiry, slight, with a thin, trim mustache. He moves with discipline the way he speaks. Every movement, like every word, is deliberate. Oh, but wait. Marianne says this man has a high red turban, slim, medium height, wearing a navy rain jacket, black jeans, and gray work gloves. He holds a large Swiss Army knife in his left hand. His rubber-soled sports shoes squeak on the marble floor. Wait. Lynn says he's 6 feet tall, very slim. He has very upright, ramrod straight posture. His beard is gray with white streaks, and he wears a dark blue turban. His eyes are dark brown and piercing. He has a hawkish nose and full lips. Jill tells us that he has a black turban, and he carries two newspapers in his recently manicured smallish hands. He's well turned out, thin man, sports a Natalie tailored charcoal gray suit that looks like it came straight from Savile Row. A rich turquoise tie is clearly displayed on his crisp white button-down shirt. And from Nova Scotia, my cousin Greg says he's stocky, East Indian-looking man, very thick, curly hair with an intense look about his eyes that indicates a strong conviction of some sort and a general high intelligence. So I'll tell you a secret. I have no idea what Mr. Singh looks like. And that's kind of the point. The point is, I have about 200 descriptions that people have given me over the years, and not one of them is the same. But the point is, I wanted him to live in your mind, in the mind of the reader. And there's a key thing writers always talk about. It's very hard to explain. It's called show, don't tell. So I don't tell you what Mr. Singh looks like. The only thing I tell you is that he wears gray flannel pants, just like a client of mine's father who came to Canada in 1980 with $8 in his pocket, as many people from India did, and spent 60 hours a week driving an airport limousine. When he came to visit me on a hot July day, he was wearing gray flannel pants. Having said that, I want to get back now to the first chapter of my fifth book, which is called Heart of the City. Now, there's a principle in screenwriting, and this is very important to think of, not just when you're writing, but when you're watching something, or even any time you're writing a letter or memo. It's a screenwriting principle. It's called come in late and leave early. Come in late and leave early. The judge, Justice Laskin, who is a terrific, he's just retired, he was a terrific writer and he taught a lot about writing. He used to say to lawyers who came to his court, stop the throat clearing. Get past the throat clearing and get right to the point. Now, at the end of the fourth book, Stranglehold, Detective Green has left Canada and gone to England. The reader doesn't know where he's going. Obviously, I had to bring him back. And so he's coming back with a young woman who is clearly reluctant to be with him. And I wrote 144 opening chapters with him on an airplane with a young woman who didn't really want to be with him. And she was on her iPad. She was trying to avoid talking to him and making eye contact with him. And finally, I remembered my own principle that I always talk about, which is come in late. So instead of being on the airplane, this is how the book starts. And it's a very short opening. Ari Green handed two passengers to the customs officer and smiled at her. The passport on top was Canadian. It was his. The one underneath was British. It belonged to the young woman standing next to him. So my breakthrough idea was forget about having them on the airplane, get them right to the passport office. "Where are you folks flying in from?" the officer asked, smiling back. "London," Green said. "Ari Green," the officer said, opening his passport. He could tell from her tone of voice that she recognized his name. He wasn't surprised. A year earlier, his name had been headline news, a top Toronto homicide detective charged with first-degree murder. And 3 months later, he'd made front-page news again when the case against him was thrown out. He watched her run his passport through the scanner of her little desk. She squinted at the screen above it. There'd be a special notation on file. She nodded, confirming something to herself. "Welcome home, Detective Green." She flipped through the pages of his passport. "You've been out of Canada for quite a while. 12 months, 2 weeks, and 1 day. But who's counting?" She chuckled. "Not me." She reached for the second passport. Her forehead crinkled when she saw it had a British cover. "Your name is Alison Gilroy," she said, turning to the young woman at Green's side. "It is," Alison said in her English accent. The officer examined the passport page by page. Most were empty. "You've never been to Canada before, not for 1 minute until today." The officer turned to Green. "Sir, I know you're a homicide detective, and I appreciate that this might be police business, but you realize I'm required to ask every foreign visitor what the purpose is of their visit to Canada." Green nodded. "Go right ahead." "Alison, what's the purpose of your visit to Canada?" "Actually, I'm not a visitor." "You're not?" "No." The officer looked at Green. He shrugged. She turned back to Alison. "Are you coming here on police business?" Alison gave her a long, slow head shake. "Absolutely not." The officer put Allison's passport squarely on top of Green's and tapped it with her forefinger. "What are you going to be doing in Canada?" "It appears I'm coming here to live." "To live? Then why are you traveling with Detective Green?" "And you always want a twist when you start a book." Allison closed her left hand and struck out her thumb in a hitchhiker's pose. "Well, it turns out," she said, jerking her wrist towards Green without looking at him, "that Mr. Green is my father." So it was a very fun and different way to start the book. And you know how I talk about setting, character, and action. It's really just about the character. Now, people ask, a lot of you have asked, is where do I get my ideas from for my novels? And all I'm really trying to do is to write about the city today as I see it. One of the great things about fiction, one of my favorite lines about fiction, is that unlike nonfiction, in fiction you can tell the truth. Now that might sound silly and counterintuitive, but if you want to know what it was like in England during the Industrial Revolution, you'd probably read, you'll think, Dickens. If you want to know what it was like in California during Dust Bowl, you'd read Steinbeck. So I'm not saying I'm a Dickens or a Steinbeck, but I'm just trying to write about what's happening in the city. So I have a tradition with my publisher, his name is Kevin, where we get together when I've got a new book brewing, and he just says, what do you see? What do you think's happening? So this was about 5 or 6 years ago, and I said to him, we were downtown, I said, come on outside, take a look. And he said, what are we looking at? I said, look at the sky. In fact, right now I can see 5 or 6 building cranes just from my my window. The city was packed with building cranes, and I did some research. The city had more building cranes than any other city in the world, except I believe Shanghai. And it was a building boom. So I got really interested in construction and the fight between neighborhoods. And then I was fortunate, one of my readers works in construction, and his company was building a condo on College Street right next to Kensington Market. And if those of you who aren't from Toronto know, Kensington Market is kind of like very preserved area, very defensive about development. So it was perfect, because we don't have time to talk about how important conflict is, but conflict is really the essence of all drama. So I had a natural conflict there. And then I had to think, well, what would Green be doing? I've always been fascinated by T.E. Lawrence, Lawrence of Arabia. I've read a lot about him. And one of the things that I find most fascinating about him is after World War One and after everything that he did as Lawrence of Arabia, and after the Treaty of Versailles, he just disappeared. And during World War II, he actually secretly went and worked on an Air Force base in India, changed his name. He just wanted to work as an engineer because he just wanted to disappear. He didn't want to be anyone anymore. He just wanted a simple life. And I thought Green, having been through everything he'd been through, that's what he wanted. So this is where Green is. But of course, you know the old gunslinger tale about having to put the guns on again. But I'm just going to read a bit of the opening chapter. One other thing I want to talk about, which I haven't spoken about before, is cadence, because cadence is really, really important in writing. And if you write just too much noun, verb, short sentence, it becomes very, very boring. So you'll see, as I read a few things, that I like to have sometimes a nice long sentence, and I always like to try to punctuate the end of a paragraph, usually with a short sentence. So just keep an eye out for that. Chapter one, and this is now set in June. The first chapter was in December, Friday afternoon. Every part of Ari Green's body hurt. His feet ached from the weight of the steel-toed boots he'd worn all week. His legs were sore from the countless climbs up and down the newly poured concrete stairs, the condominium construction site. His arm muscles burned from the weight of the metal rebar he'd been hauling around since 6:30 this morning. And he had a blistering headache. He'd worked all day in the hot sun, and during the afternoon coffee break, he'd smoked a cigarette with one of his fellow workers, who was the third time since high school that he'd lit up. "Okay, ladies, weekend's here. It's closing time," Claudio Basante, the site superintendent, said as he wove his way through the cluster of workers. He was one of those people whose face falls into a natural smile. 37 men all played their parts in a well-orchestrated ballet. The formers who poured the concrete floors and walls, the carpenters who created the wood forms the concrete was poured into, the iron workers who handled the rebar that reinforced the concrete, the electricians and plumbers who hopscotched around everyone else, securing the wiring and plumbing before the concrete was poured to seal everything in place, and the laborers such as Green, who scrambled through the two basement floors and three stories that had already been built, carrying an endless array of building materials. Above all this activity, a crane towered in constant motion, swinging back and forth like a one-armed orchestra conductor, delivering all manner of supplies to the worker bees below. In seconds, the repetitive din of metal on concrete colliding, hammers banging, and circular saws whirling all ceased. It was as if the mute button had been pushed on a loud surround sound television, replacing the noise with silence. Hard hats were removed, tools were put away, and the bright orange safety vests everyone wore were ripped off and discarded. I want you to really feel the construction site. I want you to be able to hear and see it. This was the end of Green's first week on the job, and despite all his aches and pains, he enjoyed the simple pleasure of stacking 2x4s, carrying cans of nails, hoisting the rebar on his shoulders, trudging up and down the stairs, and laying them out in perfect order, the feel of his body straining and strengthening day by day, using his muscles instead of his brain. "Before you disappear for the weekend, we got to get everything spick and span," Basante said to the crew. "Boy Wonder will be here any minute. He's coming back to kick the tires like he does every Friday afternoon. And I want this place to look as if the Queen of England slept here last night." If I'd started with this book, I would have asked you what Basante looks like, and I'm sure I would have gotten 20 or 30 different descriptions of him. So now I've introduced two characters. I have to introduce the third character. Boy Wonder was Livingston Fox, AKA Mr. Condo, or Mr. Con, C-O-N, Doe, D-O-U-G-E-H, depending on your point of view, owner, CEO, and face of Fox Developments, Inc. Love him or hate him, Fox was always in the news. A high school dropout, He'd rocketed to wealth and prominence by building well-designed condominium towers throughout the city core. He threw up buildings at breakneck speed, lived an over-the-top lifestyle, complete with a chauffeur-driven Rolls-Royce convertible, and in just 10 years, had played a key role in transforming the cityscape. He was 34 years old. That's all I'm going to read of the book. I'll tell you one thing, though, is when you create a character who's likable or dislikable, if he's dislikable, you can get the reader to kind of like him. If he's hateful, then you're just going to hate him all the time. I don't seem to be very good at writing hateful characters. I said to my agent once, the problem is that I'm a middle kid, I'm a nice Jewish boy, and I'm Canadian. So I can't, and she said, well, then you're doomed, you know. So I tend to not have nasty, nasty bad guys. And if you read the book, you'll see that he, even though he's not a character who's living, let's leave it at that, he's a complex character. So why did I start by playing the Bob Dylan song? One of the things that I do is I kind of go down a rabbit hole with things. And if I find something that I like, I try to find everything I can out about it. And if you get into Bob Dylan songs, you can spend days and weeks doing that. So this is a song I've always loved. I never quite knew why I liked it so much. And in a recent interview in the New York Times, the interviewer asked Dylan, I see that you're playing the song again. He wrote it in 1971. And the interviewer said, the song really sticks with me. I don't know about you, but you hear lyrics your whole life, but you always miss some words. So I want to read again the opening two stanzas of this song. And it goes right back to what I said at the very, very beginning. Setting, character, action. So listen to what he's written. Oh, the streets of Rome are filled with rubble. Ancient footsteps are everywhere. You can almost think you're seeing double on a cold, dark night on the Spanish stairs. Now, of course, they're called the Spanish steps, but he calls them the Spanish stairs. Gotta hurry on back to my hotel room, where I've got me a date with Botticelli's niece. Now, the version that you heard was the original version that the band recorded, and he says, with a pretty little girl from Greece. What Dylan does, like an artist, he's always changing, and it's just a funnier line. Got me a date with Botticelli's niece. She promised she'd be right there with me, and then he sinks it with the action, when I paint my masterpiece. And I think maybe the reason why he keeps singing the song is because what he's really saying is it's so hard to get things right. And any of you who've worked with me know that I drive you crazy worrying about every single word. Ernest Hemingway said, the only job of a writer is to try to write the perfect sentence. And then as I was going through this and reading the lyrics over and over, I found these two lines that really struck me. He refers in the book to it being a long, hard climb. And then he, two lines, train wheels running through the back of my memory when I ran on the hilltop following a pack of wild geese. Now, what are those two lines doing in there? And then I think, who's Bob Dylan? He grew up in a small town in Minnesota where the wind lies heavy on the borderline, as he said, the North Country Fair. And this is him to me. Although if you go online, there's all sorts of mythical interpretations of it, of this. This is me, him digging back into his past. And I can see him as a young boy, seeing the train wheels running through the back of my memory when he ran to the top hilltop to pack a wild geese. So I guess what I'm saying through all this is don't be afraid to dig into yourself. And don't be afraid with your characters to dig into their background and the foreground to really make who they are. Because we're all a combination of three personalities. And if we had another month to talk, I would talk more about characters, but we all have three faces. We have our public face here. We have our private face with the people we know well. And then we have our secret life, the secret face. And we all have a secret life. In fact, P.D. James said we'd all be so boring if we didn't have secrets. And part of our secret life is just our own memories of ourselves and who we are. So whenever you're thinking of a character, whether they're a minor character or a major character, you really have to know what's in the back of their memory. So finally, I'm going to give you a sneak preview of the new book. A little promo again. It's going to be called Downfall. We just saw the cover the other day. It's very exciting when you see the cover. And so the origin of this book, again, when I met with my publisher, Kevin, he said, what are you thinking about? And I said, what's really bothering me about the city is how it's becoming such a city of rich and poor, Toronto. When I grew up, it was a very, very middle, I grew up here, it was a very, very middle class city. You didn't see great wealth, but you didn't see great poverty. And I also, if you read my books, you can see I'm always railing against the lack of transportation and subways in the city. And I remember reading a report saying that if you lived in Scarborough, it would be impossible to get a job at the airport, because literally you'd have to spend almost 3 hours on the buses and subways to get there. And I just thought of the plight of people, of poor people, and how they're trying to work in the city. And again, remember I said show, don't tell? Books aren't didactic, they're not lectures. So I started with a character. So I'm just going to read you the opening paragraph, and then I always ask, are you in or you're out? And hopefully you're in. And you can see even in this, well, I don't know if you can see, but I've already had an last minute edit to try and get the wording just right. Here we go, chapter one of Downfall. I'm not sure if I'm supposed to read this or not, so I made a point of not asking my publisher. So don't tell anyone about this, okay? Here we go. Because the subways in Toronto didn't run early enough in the morning, Jemba Roshan had no choice but to ride his bicycle to work. His wife, Babita, was not pleased. In Canada, it is dark in November, and you don't even have a light, she said when he was getting dressed to leave. She was right, of course, but what else could she do? They needed to buy diapers for the twins, and the rent on their one-bedroom apartment was due in a week. I promise that I will be careful, he told her as he was rushing out the door, but she'd refused to kiss him goodbye. In 7 years of marriage, she'd never done that before. So let's hope that you're in. And listen, I want to thank you all very, very sincerely. When I started on these sessions, I was hoping I'd get 10 or 15 people. And I'm very gratified that you've all done this. It's got me back into my own writing. And I want to wish you all a very, very safe summer. And thanks a lot. Here we go.
Do you want to do questions?
Sure. Happy to answer some questions. Do we have any questions?
Not right now. Does anyone have any questions?
I'm not sure if I thanked my daughter Helen when my intro. I meant to, but if I didn't, I want to thank my daughter Helen Rotenberg. Without her, none of this would have happened. Thank you, Helen. You got a thumbs up.
Kevin Barnes says, being compared to Ian Rankin, how do you handle being a celebrity?
I'm not a celebrity. I'm only a celebrity at Old City Hall. That's where Kevin used to work.
Questions? Last chance.
Last chance. Listen, please send me emails and I'll make sure I get back to everyone within the next week or so.
Robert Turner says, can you devote the next series to Bob Dylan's lyrics and great storytelling?
Yes. We'll put out the cheat sheet and I'll send you to a website. You won't believe the detail that people go into on Bob Dylan. And thank you to Robert for teaching me how to edit and write and for keeping me into Bob Dylan.
Catherine says, thanks so much. When can we pre-order the book?
That's a good question. I don't know. Probably in the fall sometimes. I'll send out a note. I don't send out a lot of stuff to my reading list, but I'll send out a note once I found out about that. And we'll have an opening sometime in the winter. Hopefully people by then will be able to come out. Here we go.
Kevin says, will the new book come out in hardcover?
No, actually, there's almost no hardcovers left. People don't, even the, I miss hardcovers. I love hardcovers, but bookstores don't want hardcovers because they take up more space and most people don't like reading them anymore. Kind of funny how that's changed. There we did. Half an hour. Thanks for your patience, everyone. And again, thank you, Helen. Thank you all, and have a great summer. And please, everyone write me. I'll be happy to write you back. Bye-bye.